This one, we kind of justified it up a little bit.
And I think it's important that we really talk about this. I think this is one of those things that the Bible emphasizes and we don't as a body. I don't think the pulpit talks about it enough, because it is hard to do God's work when you are not forgiving people. It's just hard. I mean, because when you're pinning stuff up and you're holding on to things, and it's hard to show the grace of God to anyone, the love of God to anyone, when you are a hot mess full of all this anger and bitterness. Amen? So we got to learn to let that go, set ourselves free. Amen?
Amen.
So let's pray and we'll jump into it. Father God, we love you. Father, thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you for these people. Thank you for this opportunity, God. It's an amazing time that we live in. The opportunities are boundless for the church. Father, we have got to learn this step in the process, because there's a lot of things to be forgiven today. People are hurt, wounded, jaded. They're angry all the time. People are at war with each other all the time. And God, we have got to step in and be the light, but we can't, God, if we can't let it go. So God, help us today. Father, we love you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So before we get started, I do want to say something. So, you know, we have a lot of turmoil in our country today. Amen. I mean, between COVID past and COVID future. Amen. We have a lot of things going on in our culture that are, it's not, I don't want to get into the politics of it, but it's just, we're using things politically to kind of pit ourselves against each other. Amen. But can I tell you that it is truly separating the chaff from the wheat in the church? God is using this. We're seeing people under pressure. I'm trying to be as politically correct in this as I can. People under pressure in the body of Christ that are very influential, starting to kind of show their true colors a little bit.
Amen.
And so we're seeing big churches splitting up into smaller churches. We're seeing them stand up against some things that are more social than biblical. The church is rising up against that. And so we are in an amazing time as a body of Christ. Amen? But without this peace, we just become them. Amen? So we're in Matthew 18, and I'm using verse 34 today, and it says, "In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all that he owed." So what happens when we don't forgive? Before we get into how, let's talk about what happens if we don't. In Ephesians 4, 26 through 27, it says, "If you're angry, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold." So the first thing you do is you get bitter, right? Your bitterness comes from the, let me say this real quick. Bitterness comes not so much from the offense, but from the person who offended you. Can I tell you that? Let me explain this to you just a second. The closer they are to you, the worse you are offended. Amen? The quicker you become bitter. So when someone that's very close to you does something very egregious, man, bitterness sets in like that. Right? You've let this person in. You've let your walls down. That's why I always say, what is it? Trust is given slowly and taken quickly. Amen?
Amen.
So when we let people in, especially too fast, and they do things to us, bitterness sets in. So it's really about the person who does it more than what they do. Because there's a lot of things that people can say outside that way worse than what someone that's very close to you says. And you just like water off a duck's back.
Yep.
Amen. So remember that as you're going through things, the closer they are, the more it hurts. A little thing becomes a big thing because of how close they are to you. And when someone close to you deeply offends you or wounds you, your bitterness is set in rather quickly. We get bitter when we don't forgive. We do. We get bitter. And then we become emotionally unhealthy. Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. Today's anger is not the problem. It's yesterday's anger that's the problem. Today's anger is not the problem. We're supposed to deal with that today. But when we let yesterday's anger build up, and then the day before's anger build up, and we continue to let that pile on top, that's the problem. It says, do not let the sun go down on your anger. If you don't leave here with anything else today, deal with today's problems today. Amen? Because they get really ugly tomorrow. They get really bitter the day after. And then they start to affect our mental health after that, our emotional health. Amen? You want to know what the problem is? We have a lot of offended people that aren't dealing with it today.
Amen.
They're walking around just one big offense, right? They're one big last nerve. Amen? Yeah, I'm serious. They're walking around like they look at something. It's like, oh my gosh, the wind blew. Oh, I'm offended. Because their nerves are so raw. They've been offended for so long and haven't dealt with it. That now everything offends them.
Amen.
Kids today, amen. I don't get it. I mean, some things they say, I'm like, get over it, right?
Amen.
Grow up. Understand, get great expectations. People are going to hurt you and offend you, amen?
Amen.
And like we said, the closer they are, the more it's going to sting, amen?
Amen?
The problem is yesterday's anger, and when we carry it around, it starts to become unhealthy. We can't sleep. We can't eat. We can't stop thinking about it. And it will affect your well-being. So we have to deal with today's hurts today's and tomorrow's tomorrow. And the other thing is when we have so much piled up on us, we start to worry about what's coming tomorrow because we can't handle it. You ever just worry about tomorrow? You got so much on your plate, so much stuff on your back that tomorrow, you're so worried about what's coming tomorrow. That's when you know you have too much that you haven't dealt with. When you start worrying about tomorrow, you're dealing with too much stuff. And when we don't forgive, we start to declare war, don't we? Amen? Yeah. I know none of you do. Guess what? When there's war, there's what? What do we do when we go to war? We have a troop what? Build up. When you go to war with someone, guess what? You start to build your army, don't you? Amen. Try it again. You build an army when you're at war with someone, don't you? Amen. You start to recruit people, don't you? Let me tell you what they say. Come here, man. Come here. Come here, bro. And then the other person's going over, going, hold on. You got to hear my side of the story. And then we recruit, and then we become at war with each other. In war, there are sides. There are hostile wars, right? You ever been in a hostile war? We do those on social media now. We don't do them face-to-face. Right? We yell, we scream, right? We get mad, we get angry. But then there's cold wars, aren't there? Yes. Amen. Man, them cold wars, you just snub people all the time. They walk in and say, hey, how you doing? You know, right? Happens at work every day, doesn't it? If you work with more than two people, it happens every day. Amen? Somewhere in there is a war going on between factions. And the cold wars are worse than the hostile wars. See, I can deal with the hostile war. I know where you're coming from. You're yelling at me. I'm yelling at you. I'm good with that. We can have conversation. We can have dialogue, right? But when it becomes a cold war, you see that in marriage a lot, don't you? Where they just become not... They're not even roommates anymore. Somebody's renting a room at some point. Because they're so bitter, so angry, they've carried around so long, they've warred so long, right? She's got her side of the family on her side, he's got his side of the family on his side. And so they don't do anything, they don't ever interact with each other. And then they don't talk at all. We see it more than we know, right? We've all been in one of these wars or drug into one. Amen? You don't want to know why the Bible says? The Bible says that right in chapter 18, we talked about this. If you got a problem with a brother, you go to him. If that doesn't work, take somebody with you. If that doesn't work, take a pastor or somebody. If that doesn't work, take the church. You want to know the best thing to do if somebody comes up and says, let me tell you what somebody did, say, hold on a second. They're right over there. Come on, let's go talk about that. Amen. Most of the time they go, oh, no. Well, ain't that big a deal, then shut up. Amen. You know what that does? It puts the onus right back on them to start to deal with this. Yep. Or either go talk to them or get over it. Amen. But when we feed that, right? Feed the good wolf, bad wolf. We're feeding that wolf going, oh, really? Come here. Tell me. Talk to me about it. Really?
Is that
yeah. But I'm serious. If somebody comes up to you and says, hey, let me tell you what somebody did. Say, you know what? They're right there. Let's sit down. Let's talk about this right now. You become that second person. Amen? We can stop a lot of that inside the warring inside the church if we just talk to each other. Amen? Can I tell you that social media makes this way easier than it's ever been? My gosh. You know, I was on a bunch of different forums, and I just started to get rid of them. Because it seemed like all people did was bag on somebody else. Right? I did. I've got to the point now to where, you know, I follow a bunch of different things. I'm on a church creative page, and I'm on just a bunch of different things that I'm interested in. And it got to the point I was like, delete. I'm off of that. Too many people whining, too many people complaining. Because social media makes it easy to war with anybody, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Keyboard warriors are horrible. They hide behind that keyboard. I'm like, we wouldn't have said that back in my day because we'd have had to say it face to face, and that wasn't happening. Amen? You get punched in the throat for that. That's why people don't want to talk to each other, because they're afraid of the conflict. We need to bring a little conflict back. Amen?
Amen.
Rubbin is racing. Ricky Bobby. Amen. I like to quote amazing scholars such as Ricky Bobby. Amen? You open up yourself to a demonic foothold. Right? And don't give the devil a foothold.
Amen.
Anger gives the devil a foothold. It lets Satan in the door.
Yep.
He loves angry people. Boy, he can manipulate angry people. Amen?
Amen.
You know, my son used to compete full contact taekwondo. And he was really good at it. In fact, he was on his way to the Olympics when he decided paintball was a better idea. Don't you love that when your kids shift gears at about 16 and you spend all that money? Amen. Yeah. We just got back from the Olympic Training Center. He said, you know what, Dad? I think paintball would be more fun. Really? Well, I'm angry. We'll get over that. So here we go. So he used to fight full contact taekwondo. And what we tell him is the person who loses is angry. Learn to get hit and not get angry. Learn to take a punch and not get angry. And he used to do things to make people angry before he ever walked in the ring. He had stickers on his little chest protector that were not real nice about his opponents to get them angry. Because you do stupid things when you're angry. And Satan takes advantage of that. You're vulnerable when you're angry. Amen?
Amen.
That's why Paul tells us, don't let the sun go down while you are still angry. Deal with it. Jesus says, hey, if you got a problem with the brother, you right then and there, stop praying, stop bringing me money, stop doing whatever you got to do. Deal with it. Because Satan will get a foothold. Amen? In verse 34, it talks about a jailer and torture. The jailer is Satan. Amen? So when he's talking about, we're going to throw you in jail, the jailer is Satan. And he plans to use your unforgiveness to torture you. Anxiety, depression, panic attacks, right? Ulcers, health issues. You know, you can worry yourself sick. Amen? You can either walk with the Holy Spirit or Satan and the demonic. Unforgiveness leads to bitterness, and that gives Satan a foothold.
Amen.
That leads to torture and pain and misery. The Holy Spirit's the only one that can help you heal, or Satan can torture you, but it's up to you to forgive or not.
Amen.
See, that's the ticket. It's up to you. Who do you want to give the control to? You know, I see it this way. So when you're angry and you're bitter, the Holy Spirit's like on the sidelines going, let me in. Come on. Let me in. I'm right here. Like tagging into wrestling. Amen. He just wants to tag in. But we have to tag. And we do that when we forgive. Once we start to forgive, the Holy Spirit says, okay, now it's my turn. Let me deal with this. Let me help you heal with this. But when we don't, Satan goes, let me just torture you just a little more. Make you a little more bitter, a little more angry, and separate you more and more from the people that love you the most. Because unforgiveness does that. It separates us from the people that we love the most because we start to build walls. We don't trust people. We don't let people in. We don't have, hey, stupid friends, because we don't trust anybody. So we don't tell anybody the truth, and that's when we become blessed. Amen? Right? Anybody ask you anything? How you doing? I'm blessed. You're not blessed. You're being tortured inside. But instead of opening up to people that love you, you now don't trust anyone anymore because you can't forgive now at all. You know, I tell this story all the time about Robert and I going to this big old church for a pastor deal and everybody's smiling. And I said, I'm going to pray for anyone that I ask how they're doing and they don't tell me blessed today. So we're walking in. There's all these people in the parking lot, man. I mean, there's hundreds of people, pastors, showing up for this deal. And they get their whole, I think their whole church, no, really, their whole church was like 10,000 people. So there's like 300 or 400 people in the parking lot just handing out stuff and greeting people. And everybody's like, hey, I was like, how you doing? I'm blessed. Everybody's blessed. And not everybody in that parking lot's blessed. Amen. Amen. Somebody's hurting inside, need some help, need some loving, need some prayer. But see, we can't open up until we forgive. That's the beginning of the healing process. I know it's countercultural to everything we've ever been told about forgiveness. That forgiveness is the end of the healing process. That's what we've always been told, hadn't it? That once we can forgive, we can heal. We're healed at that point. We've let it go. No, 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 no. Forgiveness is the beginning of the healing process. That's when the Holy Spirit says, okay, I got this. Let me in. Let me help. But he can't help until you tag him in. Amen? Amen. So there's three kind of scenarios. There's win, 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 lose, and lose, lose. Amen? Everybody agree with that? There's three ways to do things. You can have a win, win, a win, lose, or a lose, lose. Forgiveness is win, win. That's Jesus all the way. Holy Spirit all the way. Amen? Amen. Win, lose, you control. Right? Remember we talked about vengeance and revenge and things like that. I win, you lose. That's the whole idea of us. Amen? That's how we think. Amen? I want to win. I don't care if you lose. Lose, lose? That's Satan. That's the demonic. We don't like to talk about the demonic, right? We think that's something that doesn't exist. Well, if you believe in Jesus, you better believe in the devil. Amen? Amen. So that's the demonic at that point. The lose, lose is I want you both to lose. You don't forgive, and you stay angry, and we'll all hold on to this together. That's what happens when we don't forgive. It's a lose-lose situation for all of us. It's not just a lose-lose between you and me. It's a lose-lose between everyone around both people.
Amen.
Because the war starts, right? Or you just change through it. You become more closed off. We're not as close as we used to be. We don't do the things that we used to do because of the unforgiveness that you're holding on to. When you don't forgive, it causes a ton of damage that you can't even see. Amen?
Amen.
Y'all still awake? All right, so steps to forgiveness. Here we go. So this came straight out of Christian Psychology Today. Every one of these steps came out straight out of Christian Psychology Today. Because that's light reading for me. Amen? Amen?
Amen?
All right, here we go. Step one, it has to be a daily thing. Forgiveness has to be daily. C.S. Lewis says this, to be a Christian means to forgive the inexcusable because God has forgiven the inexcusable in you. This is hard. It is perhaps not so hard to forgive a single person a great injury, but to forgive the incessant provocations of daily life. That means every day, day in, day out, grinding it out. To keep on forgiving the bossy mother-in-law, amen. I'm kidding, it's a joke. The bullying husband, amen. The nagging wife.
Yeah.
See, I set y'all up. Do you see that? I said amen twice and I looked for somebody to say amen. Every man said. Nothing. I tried to snag him into it. The selfish daughter, the deceitful son, how can we do it? Only, I think, by remembering where we stand by meaning our words when we say our prayers each night, forgiving our trespasses as we forgive those that trespass against us. We are offered forgiveness on no other terms. To refuse it is to refuse God's mercy for ourselves. It's a daily thing. It's a grind, man. Amen? Amen? It's a daily thing. This isn't an egregious. That's the easy ones. The hard ones are the little things, right? How many people in here are married, living at the house, right? Okay. I'm sure there's something that your spouse does that you don't like. Amen? Now, don't acknowledge it right now. Radonna's back here going, amen! My wife's back here, hand up, praising. praising Jesus. So there are things that we, so every day you got to forgive something. Amen. Every day you got to let something go. You just got to let it go. You got to let it go. Because you don't do it like me. I got to deal with that, right? That's that incessant every day having to deal with it every day, day in, day out, the little things. You ever just held that stuff in and then one day you just puked it all out? Amen? You ever had them fights where you're like, my hair is blowing back if I had any, right? It's like, it just all comes out because you didn't forgive every day the little things that they do every day. But then you wait till the big one comes along and then it just all comes out. See, we're just being real here. Amen? How about you just deal with it every day? Amen? Every day. People are laughing like, yeah. It's a daily activity, sometimes minute by minute, and it's a lifetime activity. Amen. You have to acknowledge the pain. Some people never get past go, as working through pain can only happen once you admit you've been hurt. Understanding that acknowledging it can intensify the feelings, right? So when you acknowledge it, you start to deal with all those feelings of that event. But don't numb yourself or stuff the emotion, as that cuts off the process of forgiveness before it ever begins. So you have to acknowledge the pain. You have to acknowledge the hurt. You have to. If you don't acknowledge it, you can't deal with it.
Amen.
Right? You ever let something just go on your car? Like that engine light came on, then the other light came on, then it started to make a really funky noise.
It still got gas.
It still got gas in it. Yep. But then that one day, whether it's got gas in it or not, it just stops because you just didn't deal with it. You didn't acknowledge that something may be wrong with this car. Amen? That's you in forgiveness. You have to acknowledge what's happened before you can ever move forward. Amen? And we're really good at just not dealing with hurt, right? We're really good with just not dealing with. We just want to stuff it in under a rug. We want to hide it away. We want to stuff it down in the recesses where we can't deal with it and we don't see it. But then something happens and it pops up and because you haven't dealt with it yet. You have to acknowledge the pain first and foremost, right? Then you got to think things through. Try writing down what happened in a journal or share with a trusted friend. Admit that what happened makes you feel hurt or angry and be honest about what emotions are rising up in you. You got to kind of think it through. You got to go through the process. Don't overthink it, but think about it. You know, you acknowledge the pain and think about it. How does that make me feel? What am I going through? All these things sound very cliche, but nobody does it. The reason there's so many counselors in the world, because we don't do things that we know we should do. We just don't do them. We don't sit and process it and talk with somebody about it. We feel like we're a burden to somebody if we open up about something or we talk about something.
Amen.
You know, you ever felt like that? Like I need to lay them out on somebody, but I just don't want to be a burden to people. Listen, be a burden to somebody, would you? You're going to be better off and so are they. You need to learn to process through things. Here's a big one. Imagine being on the other side. Think about a time when you've been in a situation of asking for forgiveness. How did that make you feel? When have you wronged another person, and did they extend forgiveness to you or withhold it? The Bible directs us to do unto others what we would have them do to us. So it can be helpful to put ourselves in the other person's shoes. Amen? The Bible says, do unto others as you would like them to do unto you. Amen? We've all hurt somebody before. We know what it feels like to be in their shoes. Now, some things are super egregious, right? We don't want to put ourselves in those shoes. We just want to put them in jail and forgive them from there. Amen? Amen. And that's okay. We talked about that. Nothing wrong with that. We can forgive them while they're on their way to jail. Amen. But the day in, day out stuff is what we're talking about. Those are the big things that rarely happen to us. We're talking about the day in, day out stuff. We know what it's like to be on the other side because they're probably upset that they hurt you. If they're a close friend or someone that loves you, they're probably upset because they have hurt you as well. So put yourself in their shoes and give them a little bit of a break. Amen? Maybe you should be the first one, maybe to reach out. Maybe you should be the first one to do something, even though they've hurt you. Because sometimes when we put ourselves in the other person's shoes, we start to see a little bit of where we were wrong also. Amen?
Amen.
I know none of you are wrong ever. Amen? You thought you were once, but yeah, that's over. But sometimes we had a little part to play in it. Amen?
Amen.
Put yourself in the other person's shoes. Remember God's forgiveness. Sometimes just reminding what God did for us softens the blow just a little bit. I think back of all the things that I've done to God and all the times he's had to forgive me. What most people will ever do to me is very minimal. I told you, man, they're going to back a truck up, several trucks, with yellow legal pads, with all my sins written out. And they're just going to start unloading them. That's every time, every one of those sins, God had to say, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you, and mean it. As far as the east is from the west.
Amen. Amen.
How far is the east from the west, the Bible says. It's not that God forgets your sins. He just chooses not to think about them.
Amen.
We have to remember how God forgave us. And that's humbling. We get off of our high horse, right? We get off of our soapbox at that point. Because don't we like in the parable that Jesus says, right? He gets forgiven, great day, goes out still on his soapbox as he has already forgotten what the king did for him. But if we daily remind ourselves what God has done for us, it'll humble us a little bit. Amen?
Amen.
You can still forgive someone without the forgiveness being accepted. You don't have to wait for them to accept it either. Because some people will never accept it. Some people will never see what they did was wrong. You know, the hardest thing for me to learn was I can't dictate how you feel. You ever had somebody say that? Well, I don't understand why you feel that way. You don't have to understand why I feel this way.
Amen.
You don't feel it. I do. That was the hardest thing for me to get to learn, that not everybody just thought just like me and acted just like me and conformed to be just like me.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Right? The world would be a much better place. My wife again looks at me like... But really, don't we all think that? That everyone should just think like us and be like us and act like us and do like us. And when they don't, we just want to flip a switch. Amen?
Amen.
Like you've offended me because you don't think like me. So what?
Amen.
Get over yourself. We have to remember that. That other people feel the way they feel. Don't minimize it.
Amen.
Don't minimize it. I've tried to learn to do that. I'm not great at it, but I try to learn not to minimize how people feel. You know, when somebody says, well, I'm feeling this way, and I'm looking at them like, I don't get it. You ever had that the whole time they're talking? You're like, I just don't get it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't, you know, it's hard for me to empathize with that.
Amen.
But there's somebody out there that will.
Right.
There's somebody out there that's been through it. What I'm really good at is finding those people and putting them together.
Amen.
Saying, you know what, I don't understand, but let me tell you, I know someone who does. Because I've listened. Again, when somebody needs to talk to you, remember I said they feel like they're a burden? Don't ever make them feel like a burden.
Amen.
Listen. Amen? Listen. Reflect on God's commands. Jesus stressed the importance of forgiving others on many occasions and even included it in the Lord's Prayer, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Pray that this would hit home in your heart, that your decision to obey would force your emotions to catch up. Sometimes our emotions need to catch up. You know, God made you as sentient, feeling beings. And what's amazing is that we're made in God's image, which means that every time that we sin against him, it hurts him. So we can't sit there and go, well, yeah, it's easy for God to forgive. No, it's not. Not any easier than it is for you. He hurts just like you. He feels just like you. But he chooses to forgive. Amen? So sometimes your emotions have to catch up to your choice. That's going through the other steps, right? Thinking it through, writing it down, talking to somebody about it. But you need to catch your emotions up to your choice. Because we should not look at it as an option to forgive. It is not an option to forgive. It's a command. I don't know how we do that either in the Bible, people. Well, I'm looking for the appendix with your name in the back where it says, well, Chris doesn't have to forgive all the time. No, Jesus says forgive. Some things like, well, I need to pray if I should forgive him. No, no, you need to pray that God will soften your heart. Amen. God commands you to forgive, not a choice. So force your emotions to catch up with the choice. Now, again, I don't want to minimize your hurt. That's why we pray about it. We look at what God did for us. We talk to people. If you have to, get a therapist. Amen? If you don't have one on speed dial, I'm sorry. You're all looking at me like, oh, I don't have one. You should. Amen? Amen. And a backup in case that one can't answer the phone. Amen? And a couple of hey, stupid friends as a backup. Because if you think you're going to handle this world on your own, you are sadly mistaken. Amen. This world is nuts. We are inundated with information. Denzel Washington did an interview, and he was really berating the media over their responsibility to tell the truth, to be truthful, not first, because right now it's a race to be first, not truthful. If you haven't seen that interview, it's an amazing interview. He's like, I felt bad for the person that asked the question, but because he kind of unloaded on her. But he was talking about how we need to, now I lost my train of thought. I hate that. Huh? Denzel Washington. But he was talking about how truth is more important than being first. And that right now, we don't know the long-term effects, here it goes, of all the information overload that we're getting. Amen?
Amen.
Because there's going to be some long-term effects from this. We're getting way too much information. Amen?
Amen.
Anybody else feel that way? There's a movement now. I digress a little bit, take a rabbit trail. There's a movement right now to unplug for 30 days a year, to take your phone, your tablet, all that stuff, and lock it in a safe for 30 days, a week, whatever it takes to decompress away from it. Amen? But his point was very... It was missed in this interview as he beat up this reporter about being truthful. But he said, we don't see the long-term effects yet, and we'll see it someday, but it's going to be detrimental to society and our emotional health. Amen?
Yep.
Because not only is the information overload crazy, it's also destroying lives in the process. Amen?
Yeah.
Let go of the hurt. The devil is an expert at getting a foothold. We have chosen not to forgive. Don't allow yourself to replay the offense over and over and over. This is where prayer is essential. As on our own, we are tempted to wander back to unforgiveness.
Amen.
Anybody else is an overthinker besides me? Yeah. Amen. Man, I'm an overthinker. Oh, my. I took a survey. One of those little, oh my. I am a horrible overthinker, an extrovert overthinker. That's crazy. But I overthink everything. I tend to replay things over and over and over and over and over and over in my mind. and I can't find the pause button. I can't find the stop button. And it's great when it's something you have to remember or something you have to do or something that you should be doing, but when it's a hurt, it's devastating. Sometimes it takes days to get it from stop playing in your head. We have to let that hurt go. Amen? We have to learn to let that hurt go. You have to continue to forgive. Forgiveness is more than just saying a prayer and moving on. It's a serious decision that we make repeatedly. The process will most likely be uncomfortable and painful, but it'll always be worth it in the end. And I always talk about this. Pray for the person that hurt you. And I've had so many people tell me, I can't. You have to. Pray whatever is on your heart. And I know people laugh when I say this, but if you want them to die a horrible death, pray it. And people laugh. They're like, I don't get it. You think God doesn't know that? You think God doesn't know how you feel? You think you're hiding it from him like a two-year-old? You can't see me. This is what you're playing. When you think God doesn't know how you're feeling or what you're thinking, you're playing peekaboo with a two-year-old. You can't see me. Because that's what you're doing. God knows how you feel. Tell him. He wants you to tell him. Because he's going to start dealing with you in it.
Amen.
Oh, yeah, you. Not them. Justice will come to them. You ain't going to worry about that. God says, I got the justice. Amen. But you, on the other hand, you're a hot mess. So pray for them. And you start out praying whatever you need to pray. And I'm going to tell you, it may take you a couple of years, but in the end, you will be praying for their salvation.
Amen.
What? It gets subtler and subtler. And I've seen it happen in my own life. I've always prayed exactly how I feel. Lord Jesus, if it were up to me, that's how I've learned. So used to, I just pray raw emotions. Now I'm always like, if it were up to me, this is what I would do. But your will be done. Your will be done. Because it's not my job to dole out the justice.
Amen.
That's hard to pill to swallow, isn't it? It's not my job to dole out the justice. It's God's job. But I'm still going to tell him how I feel. Maybe he'll hear me. Amen? You never know. But God's working on my heart. Amen? So pray for your accuser always. So what happens when we forgive? It gets really cool. Amen. We're going to finish on a good note. Amen.
Amen.
So wake up. What happens when we forgive? Ephesians 4:30 and 31. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. When we are hurt or offended, the Holy Spirit is just sitting on the sidelines waiting to jump in. As we see here, bitterness gets in the way, and bitterness leads to rage, anger, brawling, slander, and malice. God has an amazing plan for your life. It says here, you are sealed for the day of redemption. See, when we forgive, then God's plan just starts to unfold in your life. I've got a video coming out next week talking about how do you feel. Or you have joy in your life, or you bitter? Because if you don't have any joy in your life, you ain't walking with Jesus. Amen?
Amen?
No matter what's going on around you, you may not have a lot of peace sometimes, but you should always have joy in your life. Some joy in your life. And if you don't, something's wrong. Part of that's unforgiveness. Amen?
Amen.
We see God's story unfold in us when we forgive. And it comes out, I want to read a story from Acts 7, and it's the story of Stephen, and sometimes people will see Jesus through your forgiveness. So all the things that happen to you, all the great things that will happen to you, all the joy that you'll find, all the peace that you find, the other thing that happens in forgiveness is people find Jesus in it.
Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
So let me read this story. Acts 7, 54 through 60. When the member of the Sanhedrin heard this, they were furious and gnashed their teeth at him. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God. And Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Now pay attention to that statement. Look, he said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. And this, they covered their ears and yelling at the top of their voices, and they rushed him, dragging him out of the city and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witness laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. Hold on to that name too. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he said this, he fell asleep. Let's talk about Saul for a second. Saul is Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament. And what he saw was the first martyr for Jesus, Stephen. Saul's whole job was to gather up a bunch of men to go out, and he went to the Sanhedrin, he got a letter, was going to go arrest all the followers of Jesus of the way, they called it. He was going to go find them, arrest them, because that was so against religious law, and he was going to take them out, and he was a member of the Sanhedrin, and he was very learned, he was a smart guy. But Jesus looked at Stephen and said, you forgave him, I'll deal with him. He said, I got this. I'm going to find him one day on the road to Damascus. I'm going to knock him to his knees. I'm going to rise him up. I'm going to dust him off. I'm going to make him a great champion for me through this one act of kindness, this one act of forgiveness. I think that was the beginning of a change in Paul. Amen? The other part of that was Jesus was standing. Can I talk about that for a second? In every other instance, we see Jesus sitting at the right hand of the Father. Can I tell you that? Every other instance in the Bible that you'll see Jesus in heaven, anyone sees him, he is sitting at the right hand of the Father. He's not standing at the right hand of the Father. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father. Because why? What do you do when you sit? You're done, right? You're finished. What do you do at a football game when somebody does something great? You stand up, amen? You're at a ball game, what do? Stand up, amen? Boy, you guys, I'm starting over. I don't know if it's the cool weather. I don't know if y'all drank too much this weekend. I don't know what y'all did, but you're all like... So let's talk about Jesus standing. So when something great happens... When you win, when your team's winning, what do? Amen. You stand up, amen?
Amen.
Jesus is standing when Stephen forgives. Amen.
Amen.
Let's try this again. Jesus is standing.
Amen.
Amen. Golly. But as Stephen is full of the Holy Spirit and showing forgiveness, Jesus is on his feet cheering him on. And every time we forgive, Jesus is standing up and cheering for us. So I have this picture now.
Yeah.
See, I have another picture. You know, I said, it hurts my heart when I hear people say, well, I've read this book so many times, I don't need to read it again. That hurts my heart. Because I learned something. Not only is Jesus happy when I forgive, he stands and cheers me on when I do it. Now, we'll never know till we get to heaven if he really does that, but that's a great picture to think of, isn't it? That your Savior stands up when you forgive somebody and says, well done, good and faithful servant. Amen.
Amen.
Keep going. Keep pressing on. Keep moving forward.
Yep.
I got this. Right? I got that person. And that's what he was saying to Stephen. He was standing up. He was cheering. He goes, I got him. Don't you worry about him. I got plans for him. I got him. And guess what? His life's fixing to get real hard real quick. He's fixing to get shipwrecked and beaten and thrown in jail and jump out of second-story windows, and he's going to preach my word. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you. Well done, good and faithful servant. Amen. We have to understand Jesus gets excited when we forgive. Let forgiveness set you free, right? Follow me. I got this is what Jesus is saying. You'll be okay. You're mine. I love you. This is something that's more important than we tend to give it credit for. Amen. Because you really want to get set free, you got to forgive. You got to. It transformed my life when I learned this. To not hold a grudge, to not hold on to things, to let things go. Right, to try to put yourself in the other person's shoes, to listen. Don't try to dictate what somebody feels. Let the Holy Spirit fight your battles for you. I said, man, I had an anxiety medicine. I had stomach issues. I was a mess. But when I learned how to forgive, I could get rid of all of that. It truly sets you free. Amen? But so many of us just hold on to things. And can I tell you, the world needs to see this? They need a whole lot more grace and forgiveness.
Amen.
I love y'all. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father God, we love you. God, forgiveness is hard, but it's so necessary. And God, it's a muscle that we have to exercise. Father, we need to learn the act of forgiveness. It's an action. It requires work. It requires the family sometimes. God, it requires prayer. But Father, it's necessary for us to be of service to you. Because Jesus, Satan wants to torture us in it. And we allow him. So God, lay that on our heart, that the Holy Spirit is just waiting to jump in. And that when we forgive, you're standing on your feet, cheering us on. So Father, help us with that today. God, lay that on our heart today so that we can go out and shine the light and be kind to a world that needs it. Because God, it needs it. We're seeing the craziness of things, the offended people walking around at war with each other constantly. They need Jesus so bad today. So God, let us be that light to that world. Father, we love you. That's all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.